It's not all those people down at the other end and so on. This is one church. And then zero has to do with zero debt. We want to have a church where we don't have any debt as we move forward. So today I want to focus on celebrating salvation. And what you heard in those passages that Piper just read for us is 16 different times in the Gospel of John that he says this phrase over and over and over again, believing in Jesus. Believing in Jesus is life. Believing in Jesus, you come alive. Believing in Jesus is the awesomest, best thing that we can experience. John is this guy who spent 3 full years every day with Jesus. He was one of Jesus' closest disciples. It says that he was Jesus' friend. He watched Jesus perform miracle after miracle. He watched the beauty and listened to the beauty of Jesus' teaching. He saw Jesus wake up in the morning and interact with people when he was fresh. He saw Jesus at the end of a day when he was exhausted and how he interacted and loved people and cared for them. He was there when Jesus was crucified, and he worshiped Jesus when Jesus was resurrected. That John, who saw all of those things, is the same John that over 100 different times in his gospel says, believe in Jesus. Believe in Jesus. Believe the truth of what Jesus has for us. This is the gospel, this idea that Jesus came to this earth to give us life. And John, at the end of his gospel, says explicitly, I've written all these things because I want to show you and give you evidence that Jesus is the Son of God, that he said he was, that he is the Messiah, that he's the deliverer. And I want to convince you to believe in Jesus. So I'm just going to be right up front with you today. One of the things I want to try to do is talk to you. If you're here today or if you're listening online, maybe a friend or relative says, you need to listen to this sermon. Because this sermon, I really want to direct my comments to you if you're on the fence about Jesus. If you have come to a point in your life where you're not sure if you want to follow Jesus, you've come to a point in your life where you've believed and you come to church for a long time, but you're like, I'm not sure about some things and I'm considering other options. Or maybe you're at a point in your life where you're a believer in Jesus, but you can take that one off if you don't mind. We'll come to it. You come to a point in your life where you just feel like there are parts of my life I just want to hold on to and not give those all over to Jesus because I'm not sure that I can trust Jesus with those things. And so if you're in any of those buckets, this really is for you. If you're rock solid with God and you're like, I don't fit in any of those buckets, then my ask for you is that as I'm preaching, maybe you would just pray for people in the room or people who are listening who might be at a place where they're on the fence with Jesus. And this would be helpful for you to bolster your faith or to help in your conversations with family members or friends who maybe are on the bubble or they're in this place where they don't know about Jesus. And so that's my ask for each one of us as we go forward. So here's what I'm going to talk about today. Here's the outline, if you will. What does believing in Jesus even mean? Second, are there any good reasons to believe in Jesus? And then third, what does that mean for our church? If we do believe that Jesus is worth giving our lives to, what does that mean for us as a church? And then fourth, what does that mean for you as an individual? So that's the way we're going to talk about things today. So first of all, what does it mean to believe in Jesus? Let me give you a working definition. We'll put that back up on the screen now. Thank you. And I'll just give you this definition. This isn't found in the Bible. This is as I put together all the different ways that John and Paul and others talk about believing in Jesus. Here's what we'll talk about. Let's work with this for a little bit. So believing in Jesus equals believing that plus repenting from plus relying on. Now, one of my professors from Denver Seminary, Bruce Demarest, in a great theology book, wrote this. And it's kind of the idea that we'll work with, and we'll keep this up on the screen for a moment. He says, conversion, which is believing in Jesus, becoming a follower of Jesus, encompasses belief in the truth of the gospel, that's the believing that, repentance from sin, and reliance upon Jesus for life. So believing in equals believing that plus repenting from plus relying on. So believing that is going to be the facts of the gospel, like the essential truth about who Jesus was and what he did. I'm going to talk about that in a second. And then repenting from is repenting from our desire to run our lives ourselves, repenting from other gods, repenting from sin. That all, whole idea is we're turning away from those things, and then we turn toward and rely on Jesus. We commit to Jesus. We put our trust in Jesus. We give our lives over to Him. So believing in Jesus means those things, believing that, repenting from, and relying on. Believing that is the core content of the gospel. What do we believe to be a follower of Jesus? The essence of the gospel, and we've talked about this a lot, we talk about it often actually, it starts with God. God is true, God is good, God is sovereign, God makes everything. He makes human beings to be in perfect relationship with Him, to be in perfect relationship with one another, in our souls, even with the creation. And yet there's a disobedience of our first parents. They rebel against God, they sin, they turn away from God, and so there's a fall. It happens right at the beginning of the Bible. We're separated from God. There's no way we can get back to God. There's a distance. There's a sin that each one of us commits, or sins, disobedience, rebellion, and so that separates us from God. Only God can fix that gap. And so God sends His Son Jesus to give us life. He lives the perfect life that we were meant to live. He dies the death that we deserve, and He's resurrected physically, literally, from the grave so that we can have life. We trust in that. We believe in that. That's the essence of the gospel. So some might say, well, wait a second. Does the content of our faith really actually even matter? In other words, some people might ask this, I'm spiritual, but I'm not religious. Or it doesn't really matter what you believe in as long as you have belief. My wife watched this show on Netflix called The Crown. I slept through many episodes with her, which is sometimes what we do, you know, when we love somebody. But she loved this show, and in the show, Prince Philip, who's one of the main characters, he's not sure that God exists anymore, and his mom is talking with him, and she's religious, and she really longs for him to have to leave behind his worldly ways and begin attending church again. And so she asked him at one point, how's your faith? And his response was, dormant. Dormant. And so she sighs like a mom, you know, well, that's not good. And then she says this, let this be a mother's gift to her child and one piece of advice. Find yourself a faith. It helps. No, not just helps, it's everything. Find yourself a faith. So Mike Whitmer, who's a great pastor and theologian over in Grand Rapids, he wrote a book called Urban Legends of Theology, and he asked the question, but what if that faith is not true? Does any faith serve equally well? What if the thing you're believing in is the wrong thing? In every other area of life, you wouldn't believe in something unless you believed that it was true. You wouldn't stand by the open door of a small plane with a pack in hand, unsure if it's a parachute or a picnic, and just yell, Geronimo, and jump out and just hope for the best. You wouldn't do that. You want to know if it's true or not. You wouldn't pull out your car into a blind intersection, just look in the back seat and yell, shut your eyes, kids, we're going for it. None of us would do that. We want to know, is this actually going to work for me? You wouldn't, if you met with a surgeon to talk about the upcoming surgery that you're going to have, the operation that she's going to do, and she said to you, I've never seen anything like what you've got, but I'm feeling lucky, you wouldn't go through the operation, right? In no area of life would we just say, what matters is how strongly we believe in something. We want to know that it's actually true. And then, again, another objection might be, well, wait a second. Isn't religion just based on blind faith? Isn't that I need something that can be proven? I need to base my trust and my faith on evidence and reason. And I don't think it's possible. There's no way that you can prove that God exists, and so I'm not going to go there with you. In fact, there's a great scene from Indiana Jones in The Last Crusade that I want to show for you for a second that demonstrates how a lot of people think about the decision to trust in God, the decision to have faith. It's this blind leap. So watch this. You'll recognize this clip from this movie probably.
sheep from the lion's head. They prove his worth. It's impossible. Nobody can jump this.
Ah! Indy! Indy, you must hurry! Come quickly!
It's a leap of faith.
All right, so just, it worked for Indiana Jones, so it must be true. It's in the movies. But I'll just say, for me, no chance. No chance am I going to step out on this blind leap of faith. Is that what God calls us to? Is that what believing in Jesus is? Just in spite of all evidence, we go for it. Or as Mark Twain famously said in his book, Adventures of Huckleberry Finn, faith is just believing something you just know ain't true. That's the idea that a lot of people have. So is there actually good reason to believe in Jesus? Is there reasonable evidence to believe that Jesus actually is the Son of God? If believing in equals believing that, plus repenting from, plus relying on, I want to know that what I'm believing is actually true. Is it plausible? Belief is strengthened by converging lines of evidence. And so here's what I want to do for a moment with you. And some of you, this will drive you crazy. This is the engineer in me. I want to give you 20 reasons. That's why I told the staff this week, I'm giving a 20-point sermon. They're like, well, 3 hours later, you know. So we're going to do this. So here's a quote from Mark Middleburg. This is where I got these 20 from. These are great, a consolidation of different ways that we can be confident in the reality of who Jesus was. He wrote a book called Choosing Your Faith. I commend it highly. And he says this, reasonable faith is belief and action. Believing that's what his idea of belief is. And the action is the repenting from and the relying on. It's belief and action. And then he says, here's what it's based on. This is the way we live life most of the time. It's good logic and evidence, trustworthy revelation, sometimes substantiated intuition, credentialed authority, attested tradition. It's a mouthful. Let me give you 20 different pointers to the reality of God and of Jesus. 20 different ways that we can be strengthened in our faith. Not incontrovertible, these aren't foolproof, but 20 different independent witnesses to the reality of God and of Jesus. So again, you might take some pictures, whatever you want, because this is going to be a lot. A fire hose this in a few minutes, 20 different things. And three different buckets. First one is logical and scientific pointers. Design in the universe points to an intelligent designer. Whether you're looking at a microscope or through a telescope, the amount of beauty and design that we can recognize in the universe and in the created world is unbelievable. You don't even need to look further than just our own human bodies. Like whether it's the hand and all of its functions, or it's the eye, it's the immune system, any number of things is incredible. It shows the design of the universe. I love having conversations with my three kids in the medical field about the different things that they see and the way our bodies are put together and just the beauty of all of that. There's an intelligent designer. You don't see all that stuff if there's not a designer behind it. Second, fine-tuning in the universe points to an intentional fine-tuner. It's actually really fun to read, like Hugh Ross, Reasons to Believe. Scientists have discovered 50 different parameters of the universe that had to be just so within like a super, super tight window in order for there to be any life anywhere in the universe, including with us. Whether it's the relative mass of a proton and a neutron, or whether it's the power of the Big Bang, or the force of gravity and all of its different ways that it affects things, if those things weren't within just so of a tight window, there would be no existence anywhere. The universe would have flown apart, would have collapsed on itself, everything would have devolved into nothingness. There has to be a fine tuner behind all of that. There's no way. It takes so much faith to believe that all that could happen by chance. Third, I told you it's going to be fast, right? Information encoded into the DNA points to a divine encoder. I used to write software, believe it or not, for robots and for machine vision. And as a guy who wrote software, if I were to see a set of code that has all sorts of conditions and variables and the logical flow to it, I would never think to myself, oh, this probably just happened by chance. You wouldn't do that. It's not possible. There's so much information, so much logic, so much flow. There has to be in our own bodies, when you have a code of 3 billion letters in our DNA that all has to work just right, it's all working in concert with one another, there's no chance that that could be random. There's a divine encoder of that information. Fourth, the beginning of the universe points to a divine originator. According to our best scientists, the way that all of this happened is at some point, billions and billions of years ago, there was an infinitesimally small mass that included all of the mass of the entire universe. All the stars, all the galaxies, everything else was in an infinitesimally small point that had all the mass of the universe in it, and it was just stable. And at some point, something caused it to explode. And all of a sudden, everything exists. An infinitesimally small, infinitesimally high mass thing that just happened to be there, and then something happened to make it explode. That's what the best guess of the Big Bang is. Can that happen by chance? That happens to take a lot of faith. There's a divine originator. Fifth, the sense of morality throughout the human race points to a moral lawgiver. There's an argument that's made oftentimes that somehow evil and suffering and its existence in the world proves that there's no God. Let me flip that around on you. Think about all the good that happens. Think about the fact that people can love one another, can care for one another. People donate their kidneys to save somebody that they don't even know. People donate millions of dollars to help feed the poor or to rescue children from sex trafficking, to help provide food and shelter for those in war-torn countries. They rebuild cities after earthquakes. Why? Why does altruism even exist? And why do we even think about altruism as a something, as if it had a value to it? Because if there is no God, if there's no creator, if there's no originator, if there's no moral lawgiver, there's actually no reason that you should think something is good or bad. There's no reason that you would think that sex trafficking is bad. Why would you think that? There's no morality. Survival of the fittest ought to be the way that we operate. Why do we even think something is evil? Why do we think racism is wrong? What gives us the moral capacity to even make that judgment? This is, in philosophy, this is called the problem of good. Why does good even exist? See, all of those things, that they're pointers that help us to see that somehow the concept, the idea of God is more probable than the idea of not God. Let me dive deeper a little bit and talk a little bit about another bucket, which is the reliability of the Bible. Pointers that the Bible is actually a trustworthy document. First, the Bible shows itself to be a uniquely consistent religious book. We talk about the Bible as if it's one book, but it's actually 66 different books written over a period of almost 1,500 years by over 40 different authors with hundreds of different topics, and yet there's one unifying theme from the beginning of the Bible until the end of the Bible, and that is Jesus. That somehow over all of those time periods, all of those people, all those authors, there's one unique, consistent theme. See, a person might agree with that theme, they might like it or dislike it, but you have to marvel at how miraculous it is that there's one consistent theme in all the Bible. Are we doing okay? I know this is a lot. Stick with me. The Bible is a uniquely historical religious book. Other than the Book of Mormon, I know of no other religious text. I've read all of them that I know of. There's no other religious text from history that locates itself in history, in historical events, and mentions historical people and historical places, and all of its spiritual teaching is rooted in history. And it almost dares you to verify those things. All of its spiritual truth relies on the fact that it's happening within real space, real time. And then over and over and over again, when you look at the history of other countries, other nations, archaeology shows again and again that the Bible is actually an accurate historical record. It's reliable in what it teaches. It's a uniquely preserved work of antiquity. I had a neighbor once when I was in seminary, and we were talking, and he said, I can't trust what the Bible says because it was written in Hebrew, and then it was translated into Aramaic, and then translated into Greek, and then translated into Latin, and then at some point into German, and then finally into English. And somehow it's like the telephone game. As it goes along, it just gets more and more distorted. And I'm like, really? That's what you think? And he said, yeah, that's what happened. I said, no, actually, we have thousands of documents, thousands of manuscripts in the original languages, in the Hebrew, in the Greek, that we translate directly from there to here. And the amount of inaccuracy in all of those translations, in those thousands of manuscripts, is so minuscule. And it's all public knowledge. None of it's hidden. None of it is behind the scenes. There's no secret bank in the Vatican that has all the bad manuscripts. Everything is computerized. You can go see it. And I pointed to it. There's this incredible historical accuracy of the manuscript transition. We don't have the original one. We don't have Paul's signed copy that he gave to somebody, you know, in the first century. We don't have that. But thousands of manuscripts from all over the known world, all with a consistency that's off the charts. Amen? You're with me. All right. Archaeology shows the Bible to be a powerfully verified book. Almost every week, I'm reading about archaeological discoveries, most of the time in Israel, sometimes in Egypt, whatever, but each one of them adds more and more support to the accuracy of what's going on in the Bible. It's crazy to see, from pottery inscriptions to legal documents to weapons to battles to place names to people names, you name it, time and time again, even in the most incidental of details, the Bible's accuracy is verified. 10, the Bible shows itself to be a uniquely honest religious book. If you were going to start a religion, I don't know, you've thought about that? Would you, because this is what the apostles did in the time of Jesus. If you were going to start a religion, would you picture yourself as being inept, as lacking faith, as making mistakes, as reject, as like kind of rebelling, not rebelling. I'm trying to losing the word. When Jesus is crucified, they run away. It's embarrassing. That's how they paint themselves in the stories of the Gospels. And yet, these are the ones that point to a Jesus who is perfect and who is loving and who is kind and who gives us life. There's something about the honesty of their ineptitude as the founders of this religion that points to the accuracy and the truthfulness of what they're actually saying. It's honest. 11 miracles performed in the presence of believers and critics alike point to the prophets and the apostles and Jesus as messengers of God. Fulfilled prophecies off the charts number of times that years prior to something, the Bible authors say this is what's going to happen, and it comes true. Fulfilled prophecy. The third bucket, historical and experiential pointers. I'm going to walk through these really quick. Jesus' sinless life backs up his claim to be the Son of God. Jesus is said by the people who walked with him and lived around him that he never sinned. I can guarantee you that nobody I know can say that about me. And for sure, nobody that you know can say that about you. Jesus was sinless. His resurrection powerfully establishes his credentials. People saw the risen Jesus by the hundreds. They saw him crucified. They knew that he was buried in a tomb for 3 days, but they saw him resurrected. Multiple people reported this immediately after the event. Not years later, right afterward, they reported this. The emergence of the church is a pointer to the authenticity of the message. Within weeks of the resurrection, people who lived there, who saw the events firsthand, believed in Jesus. They began to worship publicly. There was nothing secret. They weren't going back behind the hidden walls and doing all this. Within 300 years, the church grew to almost 50% of the population of the whole Roman Empire. It just kept growing and growing and growing because people knew the reality of who Jesus was. 16, the changed lives of early skeptics affirm the truth of Jesus' resurrection and teaching. You don't get guys like Paul, who actually was against Jesus, who killed Christians, but who met the risen Jesus and falls on his face and begins to worship him. You don't see enemies of Jesus come to have faith in him unless there's a reality to who he is. 17, the willingness of the disciples to die for the claims they knew to be true affirms the trustworthiness of their claims. History records that the disciples of Jesus were so sold out for him that they were crucified for him. They were persecuted for him. They were executed for what they believed to be true. People don't just do that for something they know to be false. People can be sold out for a cause, but they always believe that it's true. You don't die for something that you know is a lie. 18, the changed minds of modern skeptics further support the Christian truth claims. I don't know how many times I've read biographies or autobiographies of people who were against Jesus, who set out to try to prove that Jesus wasn't who he said he was. Men like C.S. Lewis or Lee Strobel in modern days, people like Simon Greenleaf, who is the Jewish professor who built Harvard Law School into a world-class institution. Person after person who says, I set out to disprove the gospel and I became a follower of Jesus. That's support for the Christian truth claims. 19, and we'll end with this in the next. The testimonies of countless believers throughout history attest to the reality of God and the value of following Jesus. This may not be a logical reason for you that points to faith, but when you look at millions upon millions of people from the time of Jesus until today, people of all different races, ages, ethnicities from around the world who proclaim the testimony that Jesus has made a difference in their lives, I stand among those. It's not proof to you that Jesus is real, but somehow you've got to say, are all of those millions and millions and millions of people duped? Are they all completely making this up? Or is there possibility that Jesus actually has changed their life, that he's real, that he makes a difference? And then number 20, maybe the most important one, and this maybe is where you're at, and you're okay with just this one, is that Jesus actually claims that he's the Son of God. And as Pastor Andy Stanley in Atlanta area says, I'm going to go with the guy who was resurrected from the dead. If he was a guy who claimed that he was going to die, that he was going to be buried for 3 days, and that 3 days later he was going to rise from the dead, if he called his shot and he did it, I'm going to listen to that guy, not the critics. Jesus claims this for himself. So each one of these is like this picture of the door. It's a converging pointer, all saying that this idea that John's trying to get across to us, that Jesus is worth believing in, all 20 of those things are saying, yes, he is worth believing in. Now you could say, I don't believe in any of those. And I would say, show me why any of those are wrong. And maybe we can have a dialogue about that. Maybe there's one or two that you really struggle with. Maybe there's some other things. But somehow this evidence that converges is compelling. it's reason enough to believe that the story of the Bible about who Jesus is actually is plausible and maybe even worth giving your life for. That's my contention for us. I told you a 20-point sermon might go 3 hours. I'll skip something. All right, so what does this mean for our church? If we believe that Jesus is God in the flesh, that he is worth giving our life to, what does that mean for us? See, we believe as a church that Jesus came to this earth, that he is the Messiah, that he came to save us from sin. He came to bring new life to you. He came to bring new life to me, life out of spiritual death. And one of the primary tasks of the church is to witness to the reality of who Jesus was, to witness to the truth of the gospel, to his God's saving activity for the world through Christ. And so we want to point people to Jesus, and we want to celebrate with people when they've trusted in Jesus for salvation. There are over 150,000 people just within a 10-mile radius of this place that you're sitting in who don't know Jesus. 150,000. Plymouth, Canton, all the area up toward Ann Arbor, Northville, 150,000 people who don't know Jesus. And our intent is to grow in our understanding of the spiritual longings that people have, of the doubts that people have, of the things that they're struggling with, and the ways that we can help, so that we can be better equipped to help each generation of people know the reality of Jesus, to trust in the gospel. And so that's our emphasis in this increasingly de-churched and unchurched culture. We want to help point people to Jesus. And so that will mean celebrating new life through baptism. That will mean celebrating people who have walked away from God or the church, who come back and say, I'm ready to commit more of my life to Jesus. We want to celebrate that and put people up and share testimonies about the reality of who Jesus is and what he's done in their life. We want to celebrate all those things. Evangelism, which is the sharing of Jesus to the world, will be resourced and trained and modeled for the foreseeable future, which is until Jesus comes at this church. We're going to continue to encourage children and teens to trust in Jesus. Adults, people in this room, I want to continue to ask you to commit a little bit more of your life to Jesus Christ. We celebrate that, to resource that, model that, and infuse the gospel, thirdly, in every ministry of our church. We constantly want to be helping you to understand why Jesus matters and why he's worth giving our life to. That can come in sermons, it can come in small group curricula, it comes through Alpha, this great 6-week, 7-week introduction to Jesus that we offer on a regular basis and will continue to offer on a regular basis. For those who are doubting, for those who are wondering, like, how can I have a safe place to express those doubts? How can I, Mark, you're like giving us 20 reasons, you're convinced, I got that, but is there a place for me to not believe those things? Is there a place for me to ask questions? Is there a place for me to explore those sorts of issues? And the answer is yes. The answer is we want to be a place all the time, but Alpha is one of those great places. It's a small group setting where you can ask questions, experience a lot of grace and a lot of support as you're working through those issues. That's who we are. That's what we want to be like. It matters for our church that Jesus is worth believing in. Amen? Amen. And then let me close with this. What does that mean for you? I said at the beginning that I wanted to speak directly to you if you're on the fence, if you're on the bubble, if you're trying to figure out a little bit more about who Jesus is. And we began our time together by reading all those verses from the Gospel of John about believing in Jesus. So let me finish by just reading to you a couple of things at the conclusion of John's Gospel for us. See, throughout the Gospel of John, he's tried to show all of the different miracles that Jesus did. He's tried to tell you about the teaching of Jesus, and he just points to the beauty of that. He talks about the way that different people struggle with that, the times that people agreed with that. He's talked about how Jesus fulfilled one prophecy from the Old Testament after another. And here's how he closes his book. He says this, Jesus performed many other signs in the presence of his disciples, which aren't even written down or recorded in this book. But these are written for one purpose, that you may believe that Jesus is the Messiah, the Son of God, and that by believing, you will have life. Life in his name. This is John's way of saying, look, I was there. I did everything I could as I wrote this down to help you see all of the evidence that points to who Jesus was and the reality that he is the Son of God. And my goal throughout this whole gospel has been to convince you to believe in Jesus, that he is the only one worth following. And you get to the end of the book and you see this and the message to his original listeners and the message to us is now you have a choice. You have to decide. And he's shown multiple times throughout his gospel that people came face to face with who Jesus was and they turned and they walked away. He's also shown example after example of people who saw who Jesus was. They looked him in the eyes and they said, yes, I want to follow you. And John's implicit message to each one of us today is the same as it was to his original listeners. His message to you, his message to me is, here's the evidence. Now what are you going to do? Will you reject? Will you accept? There's no sitting on the fence. I've tried, as your pastor, as the speaker today, to give you 20 lines of converging evidence that includes a lot of the stuff that John does in his Gospels, honestly. And my question to you is, what will you do with that Jesus? Will you believe that the gospel is true? Will you repent from, turn from your own life, living your own way, doing your own thing, and submitting to the lordship of Jesus, and put your trust, commitment in the person of Jesus? What will you do today with Jesus? And so, Father, thank you for this incredible message from John about believing in your son Jesus, a guy who is with your son, who was there every day, who came to the point where it was incontrovertible in his mind with all of the things that he saw, that there was no other choice for him than to see you for who you really are, as the divine Savior, the Son of God, the Messiah, the one come to this earth to give us life. And he personally trusted in you to the point where he, to his 90s, continued to walk with you. All of his friends that were with Jesus, the disciples that Jesus sat with and taught with and ate with and sent out on mission, each one of those gave their life for this Jesus. And so, Father, help us today in all of our struggles, in all of our doubts, in all of our questions, to be strengthened in our faith, to know that Jesus is real, that he is alive, that he is risen, that he is here, and that we can give our lives fully to Jesus. Help us to be strengthened today in that. I pray in Jesus' name. Amen. Amen.
Let's stand together and sing this great hymn.
Oh,
So my hope is to equip you for every good work, that you might be able to go into your families, into your neighborhoods, and to be able to share the gospel with confidence, with boldness. If you're interested in any of those topics and digging in deeper, I've got literally between 1 and 20 books on every one of those 20 different topics. If you had to pick one, Mark Middleberg and his book Choosing Faith is a great choice. Tim Keller wrote a couple of books, Making Sense of God and Reason for God, that are absolutely phenomenal. They'll blow your mind. And so if you want to dig in, talk to me, read some of that stuff, pass on the link to this message to some of your friends, some of your family. Today as we leave, I want to give you a blessing, a benediction. If you want to raise your hands and lift your hearts, may you go today with just a little bit more confidence in the faith that God has given you, believing in Jesus, giving all of yourself to Him. Amen. And amen. Have a great day, you guys.